Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Berean Baptist Church for this God and Country Day. Just a second, I'm going to get one of my choir members. Brother Goodman, the choir is looking for you. Just getting everybody where they need to be right now. So anyway, we're all going to stand together and we are going to sing a patriotic song. Brother Jim Grew will lead you in that song.
All right, number 127 as we sing, Oh Beautiful for Spacious Skies, 127. All right, sing it out now.
Oh.
Please remain standing as we together recite the Pledge of Allegiance. Let's begin together. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please remain standing for the Star Spangled Banner. We are grateful that you are here with us this morning on this special Sunday before the 4th of July. I am grateful for our country. I am grateful for America. Sometimes people say, well, I have room to complain, and certainly you can if you want. But as of today, America is still the greatest country on earth. I can't tell you what tomorrow will bring, but I can tell you what today is. So let's thank God for the America that we have today. Let's have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come before you, we who know history know the intent of our founding fathers. We know the intent of our fathers was to have a country that had a freedom to worship God, not a freedom from worship, but a freedom to worship. We know their heart. We know how much they loved you. We understand how much that they sacrificed. And Lord, if there be any here and they do not understand, I hope that understanding would be made clear this morning. And we come here to pray for America. We know the vital presence of this country when it refers to the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us to be faithful and true and righteous citizens in this land that you've placed us in. And help us in this service. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you, choir. Let's stand as we have an opportunity to sing our greeting hymn, which is God Bless America. Sing it through once and then we'll greet one another.
God. Thank you.
Brother Jim Giroux. Just looking real quickly, I know we're on the last Sunday of the month, but if for some reason you do not have the bulletin of the month, we want to get that to you. Just raise your hand and we'll be sure to put that in your hand. Christy will get one up to you as well. And right here, and you know what, Caleb, this young man wants one too. I'll give one to you. It's good having you. His first day in church here today. Glad that you came today. And then right there, Caleb, do you have any left? He's getting more here. We'll give one here to Robert and Michael back in these rows. We'll give you guys one as well. That's one of the wonderful things about it being the last Sunday of the month. This is like handing out candy. So anyway, Laurentius wants one too. How are you doing, Caleb? We'll get one to you as well. And do you have any others left? He's looking. He's checking right now. Okay, because Abigail wants one too. Okay. Okay, now, guys, these aren't paper airplanes. Okay, the rest...
What happened to the three we already
got? I know. Okay, the rest of you guys, I'll catch you after service. I'll get you, Killian, after service. Just go to Brother Glenn at the end of service. We'll get you another one here. Going to start something that will never... Oh, do you not have one? Yeah, look at you. Mick, welcome back. Good to have you here. Even your sense of humor returned with you. So anyway, glad to have each and every one of you here. Listen, we are heading into something really, really big. And so I appreciate your prayers for the I Love America Conference. The response has been far greater than last year. Tomorrow night, everything starts at 7 o'clock. If you get here at 7 o'clock, you may want to prepare to sit in the balcony. That is what it's going to be like. It's going to be a very, very full house. And so if you have a favorite chair, you're going to have to do something, come early and claim it. Just letting you know, we have elected officials that are coming, many, many military men that are coming. And the emphasis this year on I Love America is for God and country. And so we are focusing particularly on Monday night on our armed forces. I want you to pray for many, many people that are traveling. Our choir is going to be super-sized tomorrow night, probably more than double the number of choir members that you saw right now. And so this is going to be a very large event. Amen. Have at least one more coming into the orchestra. But be in prayer for people that are traveling. Pastor Brad Wills of Graceway Baptist Church, he landed late last night in Boise, Idaho. He is traveling cross country this afternoon. He will be our guest speaker tonight in our 6 o'clock service. Now, so our schedule's been completely altered. We have other pastors and delegations coming in, yes, tonight, not only tomorrow, but tonight. And so because of that, our schedule's been altered. Choir, your rehearsal's at 7:15. Because at 4:30 this afternoon, it's a setup. And what I mean by that is I need help of individuals. We have to transform certain areas on the stage. We have to transform the junior church room into something entirely different. And it's going to take a lot of help so we can get that prepared. So if you can make it at 4:30, you would be greatly appreciated. Because this is God and Country Day, we are having our annual God and Country Day meal right after the morning service.
And say amen to that?
Do we have an amen? Brother Jim's looking for amens. Brother Jim is amening up here. And anyway, it's going to be a wonderful meal. By the way, when we have conferences, I'm just letting you know, we have food. And so Monday night is cake and pie night. We'll probably try to get some fresh fruit out there as well. And we need some more cakes and pies. There's a sign-up list in the foyer. Here's something I've discovered about pastors in the ministry. I mean, you'd think they'd eat somewhere else, but they always come hungry. And so anyway, we're going to have that. We will have a continental breakfast at 9:15 on Tuesday morning. We will have a combined session at 10 o'clock Tuesday. We will have a split session at 11 o'clock Tuesday. Pastor Addison Smith of Grants Pass Baptist Church, God has blessed that man. He started his church in the middle of COVID. He now owns his own building in less than 4 years. It's an absolute miracle. But once you meet him and see his energy, you'll understand. He has more energy in his little finger than I have in my whole body. But anyway, he's coming to speak to our youth. And so we will have a youth breakaway. We'll have a ladies' meeting with Mrs. Wells. And of course, there will be a luncheon for all parties here. And then 5:30 is our old-fashioned American barbecue. It's going to be the hamburgers and the hot dogs and the baked beans and the potato salad and the watermelon. We're going to have a wonderful time. But I do need your help on making the meal. So go ahead and look at that sign-up list and see if you can help regarding that. Just want you to know about those things that are coming. And again, I want to say this in advance. We have 4th of July on Thursday. Let me say in advance, happy 4th. I hope it's very, very wonderful for you, and that you can spend it with family and friends, and that you can either see a fireworks display or create your own without getting injured. And but anyway, many, many things that are coming. And I do want to say this to our congregation, and that is today, Monday night, Tuesday night, we will have love offerings. Those love offerings are not for the church to pay for the conference. Those love offerings, every penny, are going to be going to our guest speakers. They're going to be going to Pastor Wells and the ministry of Graceway Baptist Church. They're going to be going to Brother Addison Smith and the ministry also of Grants Pass Baptist Church. You're going to help Mrs. Wells be happy as well. You always want to make the wife happy. I just thought I'd let you know that. And so we have those items going on. But anyway, just encouraging you as a congregation, pick one of those nights and be generous and help them. These are incredibly busy people that are really carving time out just for us. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing. Is there any other announcements? I forgot I did. Okay. And that is our monthly devotionals for July. Both the Dwell devotionals and the Baptist Bread are out in the turnstile starting tomorrow, July 1st. Want to make sure that you have those. Is there anybody and you say, I want to give an invitation to my friend. I forgot, but it's not Monday night yet. We have posters and we have cards. Is there anybody that needs one of those? We've been trying to paper the town, and we got 950 door hangers out yesterday. Just looking here, right here, yeah, we can get you one. You can take that home to your parents. They might be interested in coming. And so we will do that. We'll give you one of those right now. So, okay, I think that I've announced enough. At this time, we're going to have the men come and receive our Sunday morning offering. This is an opportunity that we have to give to the Lord of our tithes and offerings. Thank you for praying for our ministry. I'm here to tell you that brand new July gospel tracts are in the mail. We hope to have those by next weekend. It's a patriotic tract about praying for America, and so we hope those arrive soon as well. Thank you for supporting our missionaries. They continue to touch base frequently. Thank you for praying for Brother Childs down in South Africa with surgeries that he's had that he's recovering from. So grateful for that. Let's have a word of prayer. Ask God's blessing on this offering. Brother Carl, I'm going to ask if you would bless the offering, please.
Our Heavenly Father, we truly want to thank you. Thank you for the formation of this country that you were truly involved in. Thank you for the great awakening that preceded that prepared people for this country. Lord, we pray that you would just bless our country, help it heal its ailments, Lord, and just help us to be a part of what we need to be for you. And Lord, we thank you for the great salvation you've given. And Lord, we just give you glory for all that's done. We ask that you would bless the giver and thank you for their offerings. And Lord, we pray that you would bless everyone here. We love you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And it seems the world is
Okay, go ahead and find your songbooks and stand as you are standing. Also letting you know that it is 44th anniversary Sunday of Berean Baptist Church. Happy 44th anniversary. And of course, what do we do with anniversary? Well, we have cake. And so there's an extra cake downstairs. Also, see if you can grab a slice of that. It'll be first come, first serve on that one. I'm sure it will be. Brother Jim.
All right, number 46 in your hymn book, When I See the Blood. Then we're going to have some preaching. Some preaching. 46.
Christ our Redeemer died on the cross, died for the sinner, paid all the due, sprinkled his soul with the blood of the Lamb, and I will bow, that's over you. When I see the blood,
singing. We are going to begin by looking in the Word of God. If you have your Bibles, is Galatians chapter 5 that we are heading into. If you do not have your Bible, there will be a Bible in the middle pew in front of you. If you don't know where Galatians is, there's a wonderful thing in the Bible called Table of Contents. I'm glad that it's in there. I don't know if the Table of Contents is inspired, but it certainly is helpful. And so Galatians chapter 5 is the verse that we're looking at as our text. And once you have that, we are going to read this verse out loud together. Galatians chapter 5, looking at verse 1. So everybody is thumbing, everybody is moving. Very good. People pulling out their smartphones, it's easier, I know. So here we go. Galatians chapter 5, looking at verse 1, let's read out loud together.
Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage.
Let's have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I believe that you have placed us in this church building for a time such as this. Our nation, once again, is at a crossroads. And there is a crossroads for every generation. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us to understand, as your children, our divine responsibility regarding our country. That we would understand what purchased our country in the first place. That we would understand the only thing that can truly save our country and our fellow citizens. Please use your word in our hearts this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. It was 248 years ago that men debated the concept of American independence from the British in a building in Philadelphia that is now known as Independence Hall. The debate was loud. The building was hot. And so the upper windows were open to the building, inviting the horseflies, so that the slapping of them was louder than the debate that was going on inside the room. Much was weighed by each of those who voted for freedom. Of those who voted, it sank in that declaring freedom was one thing. Purchasing it would be quite another. 13 years of war would leave most of them either penniless or dead. They were the true heroes of their day. Today, America is a city on a hill, meaning it cannot be hid, even if she wanted to be hid. Our enemies see the faltering of leadership, and we plainly see the uncertainty of our day. Freedom always looks more precious when we are in danger of losing it. It is time to remember that freedom always has a purchase price. The message this morning is called The High Price of Freedom. And there is scriptural examples of others that were caught in the balance, that needed to make the sacrifice, that needed to make the purchase, that needed to look to the right things, look to the right people. And so we are going to look at this time briefly this morning, because if it was long, I know it's mealtime, you would begin chewing your arms, and I do not want to see that from here. Please turn with me to the book of Exodus. Exodus, easy to find, the second book of the Bible, and we actually are turning to Exodus chapter 1. The book of Exodus chapter 1, we will find an example of why freedom is indeed necessary. Look with me in verse 13 of chapter 1. And the Egyptians made the children of Israel to serve with rigor, and they made their lives bitter with hard bondage in mortar and in brick and in all manner of service in the field. All their service wherein they made them serve was with rigor. And in chapter 2, looking at verse 23, and it came to pass in the process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage, and they cried, and their cry came up unto God by reason of the bondage. And God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. Here is the point. Whether it be Egypt, or whether it be Britain, or whether it be your own personal sin, bondage will make you cry out. When we look at Moses, we see that the bondage was grievous. We saw that the people served in great pain and in great trepidation and in great torture and in great disdain and ridicule. It was a terrible, terrible time. And one day was like the next, was like the next, was like the next. And they cried out, and they sighed, and they remembered there was a God in heaven. Here's the good news. God in heaven remembered there was them as well. Understand, bondage will make you cry out. It is grievous. And what our country was facing with Britain, it was beyond reason. They were taxing everything. Now, by the way, Britain still does. They still do tax everything. But they're taxing everything across the sea. And there was taxation without representation, where nobody had any say regarding the taxation. And the burden was getting heavier and heavier and heavier. And then also as a result of the Great Awakening that took place in 1720, when many of you realize Jonathan Edwards, the sermon Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, that him and many other evangelists that were in our country at that time set the nation on fire on things of the Lord, and local churches began to spontaneously spring up all across this great land of ours. And England had trouble with it. They were not registered churches. They were not the correct brand. And so England was trying to clamp down also on freedom of worship. And so you had the bondage of taxation, and you had the bondage of the removal of the true worship of God. And bondage will make you cry out. And there was 13 colonies that were crying out to God and crying for help and crying for deliverance and crying for direction. But then, as we've already seen in the book of Galatians chapter 5 verse 1, and that is, sin is a heavy bondage, and it's warned against. It says, be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. And here is the tragedy of it. The devil, in his goal with sin, his goal is to overcome you. His goal is to defeat you. His goal is to destroy you. The scripture says in 2 Peter 2:18, for when they speak great swelling words of vanity, they allure, it means they seduce, through the lusts of the flesh and through much wantonness, which means anything goes, those who were clean escape from them who live in error. In other words, it's called corrupting the righteous. While they promise them liberty, they say sin is freedom, is what they're saying. While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage. Sin will overcome you. Whether it be Moses back and the children of Israel in Egypt, whether it be the colonists who labored under the bondage of a nation across the sea, or whether it be our own personal sin, bondage will make you cry out. So if you're going to cry, cry to the right person. Cry to somebody who can do something about it. Cry to Almighty God. Cry to the person in heaven who looks and sees the trouble that you're in. There is another point. We're still in the book of Exodus. You have been in Exodus chapter 1. You have been in Exodus chapter 2. I'm making you work really, really hard. You are now going to be in Exodus chapter 3. I think you can handle this today. The book of Exodus chapter 3, looking in verse 13. And Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel and say unto them, the God of your fathers have sent me unto you, and they shall say unto me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. He said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you. Why is I am so important? Because you know what? If you're in trouble, you don't want I was to come to you. No extra charge. We watched a debate this week. I think we saw some "I was." You do not want "I was" to come to you. You do not want "I will be" to come to you. If you have trouble today, you don't want to wait till tomorrow. You need help now. And so understand, someone must ask, what will make freedom possible? And Moses is saying, is there somebody that I can tell these people that will make freedom possible? Yeah, tell them "I am" is coming. The Bible says God is a refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. We don't want to go where God was yesterday, and we don't want to hope that God will come tomorrow. We want to know that God is here with us today. So someone will ask, what will make freedom possible? And so you have Moses who realized the great I am makes freedom possible. There's somebody else years later who knew that freedom was possible. And on June 8th, 1783, General George Washington penned these words to the colonies that were now the new states, still in the middle of the Revolutionary War, by the way. "I now make it my earnest prayer that God would have you and the state over which you preside in his holy protection." I'm sure glad that there was a general who knew who to call to in time of trouble. And indeed, we have the painting of George Washington praying in Valley Forge. And of course, the skeptics and the revisionists try to say, well, it didn't really happen. Remember, they're the same revisionists that said the Hittites weren't in Israel, but they found him. David wasn't a real king, but they found him. Understand, the skeptics, there's a term, it's called higher criticism. All it is criticism. And there will always be those who will criticize. And there will always be those who rewrite history. But I'm here to tell you that the father of our nation, George Washington, was a man of faith. And he was a man of resolve. I'm sure glad that he had others who decided they would resolve himself with him. Understand, someone must ask, what will make freedom possible? There was a father with a demon-possessed child. Those of you who are with me in Sunday school and understand spiritual warfare, you heard some of this verse already. And a demon had possessed this child since he was very young, and the demon was trying to destroy him. And that father had made it his life's mission to save his child. And he would pull that child out of the fire as the demon tried to burn him. He would pull that child out of the water as the demon tried to drown him. Indeed, this father is afraid to turn his back on his child for fear that his child would be destroyed. And so he came across Jesus. And here's what he said to Jesus. "And oft times it hath cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us." Someone must ask, what will make freedom possible? Someone needs to say to Almighty God, "God, have compassion on us and help us. God, for the sake of America, have mercy on us and help us. For the sake of the future of this great nation, please have men turn to you." Because he's the only one who can make freedom possible. Thirdly, faith in a Savior must be necessary. We have to look. Listen, I spend all my life now over my head. I just thought I'd let you know that. You know, I live every day in the ministry, and you go, "Pastor, how's it going?" Well, I'm either here or here, but I'm underwater all the time. I am always asking God for help in the ministry. And faith in a Savior is necessary. It was necessary for the children of Israel to trust in Moses because God provided them a Savior to get them out of the land of Egypt. Now, I'll be very honest. They didn't trust him very well. There's a whole nation that were just a little bit problematic. The next generation that came up were a whole lot better. And can I be honest? Americans are that way too. We're the most prosperous nation on planet Earth, and there is nobody who can complain better than an American. It's just the reality. God has given us so much, and we gripe about everything we get. We're kind of like the children of Israel, with manna falling from the sky and water coming from the rock and saying, God, what have you done for me lately? Here's the thing. Faith in a Savior must be necessary. Trusting in Moses. Or you had people, and they had to trust in General Washington. And let me tell you something. Sometimes the stakes seem so against them. And you had men, and their clothes were tattered, and they had no shoes on their feet in the snow. No, this isn't a grandpa version of going to school. This was the real thing. They were tired, and they were shoeless, and they were hungry, and they were unpaid, but they believed in the vision of General Washington, that we needed to have a free nation. We needed to have a nation that was free of foreign taxation. We needed to have a nation that actually had freedom of worship. And George Washington was a wonderful man. But this is where we need to think. Human saviors come and go. There's been General Washington. There's been Teddy Roosevelt's. There's been John MacArthur's. There's been Norman Schwarzkopf's. But they come and they go. Wouldn't it be wonderful to have a Savior that didn't come and go? There is one. His name is Jesus Christ. And you go, well, I'm sure nobody doubted him when he was on this earth. Want to bet? John chapter 6, verse 67. Jesus had preached a hard message, and he had a backdoor revival. Everybody headed for the doors. And there's the disciples just standing around him. And then Jesus said unto the 12, will you also go away? Then Simon Peter answered unto him, said, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life, and we believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God. No, faith in a Savior must be necessary if you're ever going to see freedom happen. But understand, there's a price and there's a cost. Somebody has to pay the price for freedom. If you're still in the book of Exodus, go to Exodus chapter 12. Book of Exodus, looking at chapter 12. Without a doubt, and this is important to understand, freedom is purchased in blood. Exodus chapter 12, and we're looking at verse 5. And there's instructions to protect God's chosen people. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year, and ye shall take it out from the sheep and from the goats. And ye shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month, and the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening. And they shall take the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper doorpost of the houses wherein they shall eat it. And also in verse 13, and the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. And did you catch the word pass over? And this was the very first Passover that ever existed with God's chosen people. It is the most important holiday of the Jewish people. And the interesting thing about the holiday, it's about freedom being purchased by blood and protection being purchased by blood. Without a doubt, freedom is purchased in blood. It must be that blood that protects. It must also be that blood that will actually pay for something. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, This then is the message that we have heard and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And here's the phrase. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. I think that word all is very, very important. There are many religions that say, oh, he just cleanses you from some sin. There's other religions that say, oh, it's only a down payment. You have to pay for the rest of it. That is not what the Bible says. The Bible says that the blood of Jesus Christ, it pays the price. And it pays the price of all sin. And so what we have, if you're still in the book of Exodus, can I get you to go over one more book? Can you go to Leviticus, the very next book, and go to Leviticus chapter 4? Because what we have to do, as you see, as we're dealing with God's chosen people, it was a lamb. It was an atoning lamb. And we see more about that in Leviticus chapter 4, verse 32. The scripture says this, and if he bring a lamb for a sin offering, he shall bring it a female without blemish, and he shall lay his hand upon the head of the sin offering and slay it for a sin offering in the place where they kill the burnt offering, and the priest shall take of the blood of the sin offering with his finger and put it on the horns of the altar of burnt offering and shall pour out all the blood thereof at the bottom of the altar. And at the end of verse 35, and the priest shall make an atonement for his sin that he hath committed, and it shall be forgiven him. Now I will make one notice here. That is an atonement. Okay? That is an atonement for one sin. This is going to be quite a process. But understand that the atoning blood of a lamb and the lamb that was a Passover was all prophetic, because there was an eternal lamb that was going to come that would be the fulfillment. And indeed, it's that eternal lamb that John the Baptist actually talked about in the book of John chapter 1 verse 29. And he said, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. And so there's an eternal lamb, and he takes away the sins of the world. But since you are good at finding things in the Bible, could you now go completely over to the other side and go to the book of Revelation? Like I said, easy to find the first book of the Bible, easy to find the last book of the Bible. If you're in the concordance, you haven't gone far enough. Revelation, look at Revelation chapter 13 with me, because this is very, very important. Because I want you to realize that we're looking at a prophecy that is the future, but you're going to be stunned what God is being praised for in this passage. Revelation 13, verses 8 and 9. And it says, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If any man have an ear, let him hear. And what he is saying is this, says, even those that are lost, even those that are burned in hell shall worship him. But I want you to notice what it says about the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. Go, wait a minute. Okay, I've read my history books like you did. Okay, I know that Jesus was slain a little over 2,000 years ago. That's not what it looks like in heaven. And that's not what it's like for you. You see, because Jesus was not simply man, he was God, and he was the eternal God. And so when Jesus was slain on the cross, in that moment of time, the purchase price of his sacrifice flowed both directions on the timeline, all the way to the foundation of the world to pay for the sins of Adam and Eve, and all the way to the other side to pay for the last person who will receive Christ in faith. It went both directions on the timeline. And so guess what? The Bible is right. We are wrong. He was slain from the foundation of the world, because what the eternal God can do in sacrificing, he can make an eternal sacrifice, because he's not the great I was, and he's not the great I will be. He is the great I am every single day. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so he's the eternal Lamb from the beginning of the world. And what is he given? He is given one eternal sacrifice. We have the blood of patriots that founded our nation, but they could only sacrifice on the day that they sacrificed. Jesus is not that way at all. And then you go, well, who could Jesus sacrifice? Did he just sacrifice for the people of his day? No, he has sacrificed for the people every day. The Bible says this in Hebrews chapter 10, looking at verse 10. The scripture says, by the which will we are sanctified, that's present tense, through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. So we have, he's an eternal Lamb, and he sacrificed for the sins of the whole world. And he's sacrificed from the beginning of the world to now, that one moment in time that took care of the sin debt of the entire world. The one eternal sacrifice. And he is also that one eternal sacrifice for all those who believe. 1 John chapter 2, verse 2, we're almost done here. And he is the propitiation. That word propitiation means the atonement. He is the atonement. Not the atonement for one sin, like in the Old Testament. He is a propitiation for our sins, plural. I'm sure glad for proper language here. It's plural. For our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And so it's an atonement for all who will believe. It shows the availability, the payment of the sin debt. And I'm here to tell you, I look at our country and we need a savior. And we need a champion. And some of you may think, I found my champion. I'm going to vote for that champion. If you can figure out they don't change champions on you before November, and you figure out, I'm going to vote for that champion. That champion's going to come and go. You need a champion that lives forever. You need somebody who can save you for all eternity, not just save you for the moment. With each generation, America's freedom is in doubt. This is really true. With every generation. But that's America. That doesn't have to be you. The Bible says this in Romans chapter 3, looking at verse 24. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation, there's that word again, through faith in his blood. To declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say, at this time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. The price for freedom is very high. Is very high. In 1776, there were 13 years of blood and sacrifice that followed 1776. Many people don't know it. They think literally that on July 4th, 1776, the Declaration of Independence was signed, and then July 5th, they put up a McDonald's. That's how much they know about American history. But it was paid for in blood. And understand, your freedom has been paid for by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. He has paid the high price of freedom. But the person in bondage must call out to him. The person in bondage must have faith that a Savior must be necessary. And you must have faith that Jesus purchased your freedom. Have you ever called out to Him? Have you ever come to Him? Let us have a word of prayer. We'll have a word of prayer and we'll extend an invitation. An invitation is exactly that. It's an opportunity that every person has to make a decision about what the Word of God says. And perhaps today you are sitting here and you go, I don't know about my future. I've been religious. I've even believed in God. I've gone to church some. I've done a few things. But I've never ever called out to Jesus for eternal salvation. I've never ever accepted His payment on the cross as the payment for my sins. The Bible is quite simple. It simply says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So there's a payment that has been made, but the pardon must be received. The Bible says, but as many as received Him, that being Jesus, to them gave He power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name. Do you believe Jesus is who He says He is? Do you believe that He did what He said He did? And do you believe that He can pay for your sins right now? Dear Heavenly Father, please use Your Word in our hearts. Let this be an Independence Day for us, where we're able to declare freedom from the bondage of sin, where we're able to declare freedom from the penalty of hell, where we can embrace the promise of heaven, because there is a Savior who freely and sacrificially paid for it. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. The song is number 64, Lead Me to Calvary. And let's stand together. You can open your songbooks. I'm here to tell you there's an open altar for somebody who feels that they pray. You may have a burden in your heart and you just want to lay it at Jesus' feet. That's biblical, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. But there may be a greater need, and that greater need may be eternity. And if that's the case, would you please come this morning so you can be shown in the Word of God how you can know for sure if you died, you go to heaven. Let's sing together while we sing, You Come.